The Bible contains remarkable stories of miracles and divine interventions. Moses parted the sea. Peter healed a man lame from his mother's womb. Jesus drove demons out of people and raised others from the dead. But are these types of events still happening today?
We too have a beam of divine light and guidance that God has put within the heart of every man. And it's one of the greatest proofs that there is a God.
More amazing supernatural things are happening than we realize.
This is Divine Intervention, the interview show that features intriguing people who've experienced the hand of God in amazing ways. Divine Intervention was created and produced with the purpose of encouraging believers, spiritual seekers, and skeptics alike that Jesus is alive and is still performing miracles and working in the world today.
I believe in miracles.
Here's your host, Daniel Fazina.
Hello, friend, and welcome to Divine Intervention Radio. Yes, I am your host, Daniel Fazina. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy schedule to spend an hour with me and hear another exciting and powerful testimony of how the Lord has worked in someone's life. Before we get to our amazing story and special guests, I want to remind you that you can always find Divine Intervention at divineinterventionradio.com. These shows are archived there, and also at facebook.com/divineinterventionradio, and on YouTube, youtube.com/divineinterventionradio. All right, friend, today's explosive interview is one of the most controversial, if not the most controversial, I have ever done. I am so excited, so blessed, and encouraged to be able to bring you an example of God's scandalous grace. Today, I'm going to be interviewing a husband and wife couple, and the man was intimately involved with one of the greatest conspiracies, tragedies, and crimes in American history. I'm talking about the date, 1963, November 22nd, Dallas, Texas, Dealy Plaza. I'm talking about none other than the unfortunate and tragic assassination of John F. Kennedy, our nation's president. Now, the official story has always been that Lee Harvey Oswald shot Mr. Kennedy from the Book Depository building in Dealy Plaza, hitting the president from behind. There were three shots fired, and the Warren Commission said that Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone. However, that day, Mr. Abraham Zapruder was in Dealey Plaza recording with his film camera and captured the tragic event on film, and it appears to show President Kennedy being hit from the right front. That spawned a lot of conspiracy theories, countless books, and even movies suggesting that there was a shooter on the grassy knoll to the right of the president's motorcade. Now, I wasn't even born at the time this tragedy took place, and many people listening to this broadcast probably were not as well. This was 57 years ago we're talking about. So let's go to a clip from CBS News that was from that day, November 22nd, 1963, to kind of set the stage for what we're going to be talking about today.
Brian Guide in our newsroom in There has been an attempt, as perhaps you know now, on the life of President Kennedy. He was wounded in an automobile driving from Dallas Airport into downtown Dallas, along with Governor Connally of Texas. They've been taken to Parkland Hospital there, where their condition is as yet unknown. We have just learned, however, that Father Huber, one of the two priests called into the room, has administered the last sacrament of the church to President Kennedy. From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago.
The bulletin is that our correspondent in Dallas, Dan Rather, reports that the Dallas police have arrested a 30-year-old man who was found with a weapon in his possession.
Here is the suspect. Will you roll it, please?
Did you shoot the president?
I didn't shoot anybody, no, sir.
You just heard Oswald, who said he did not shoot anybody.
As this day draws to a close, here is a brief summary of its events. Upon today's assassination of President Kennedy, Lyndon B. Johnson became the new president of the United States. This is Harry Reasoner. Good night.
You're probably wondering why we're talking about this subject on Divine Intervention Radio. What does it have to do with miracles and God? Well, let me set it up for you. I stumbled across an interview on the internet of a man named James Files, and he supposedly had confessed to being the Grassy Knoll shooter. And I was fascinated with this possibility, and I watched this three-hour interview with this man taken in Stateville Prison, and he went through a lot of details about that day. Now, the FBI has officially declared Mr. Files as not credible. He seemed credible to me, but the real thing that intrigued me was the part where he said that he had gotten involved with a Christian woman who was writing to him and witnessing to him and praying for him, and he eventually gave his life to Jesus. This is what it took to take this hardened criminal. I mean, this guy is a career criminal, okay? We're talking about running chop shops, all types of fraud, being a contract hitman for organized crime and the CIA. Not a nice guy. Not a nice guy at all. But someone who is not beyond God's grace either. Today you're going to hear straight from Mr. James Files and his wife Pamela. So when I saw his video, the fact of his conversion really intrigued me, and I wrote to him. I looked him up, and I wrote to him the first time in 2009, and we developed a relationship. We wrote many letters back and forth to each other, and I can tell you he is a born-again Christian, a genuine man, and we developed a friendship and built trust over the years. So this interview is coming to you many, many years in the making. Starting from 1963, but my part started in 2009. So again, we were pen pals until Mr. Files' release from prison in 2016. All told, he's spent over 30 years in prison, and he is now living a new life with his wife on the outside, and he has agreed to give me an exclusive interview to talk about his part in the Kennedy assassination and the dramatic divine intervention that he experienced in his life. James and his wife Pamela want to get the truth out about what really happened with the Kennedy assassination. They are the authors of several books, including Interview with History, The JFK Assassination, and Primary Target JFK, How the CIA Used the Chicago Mob to Kill the President. Their website is jfkmurderjamesfiles.weebly.com. And it's my pleasure to welcome James Files and his wife Pamela Ray Files right now on Divine Intervention Radio. Pamela and James, welcome to Divine Intervention Radio. It's an honor to have you. Thanks so much for being here.
Thanks for inviting us, Daniel.
It's an honor, Daniel. I've known you for some time, and I really appreciate this, and I'm thankful it's you that I get to talk to.
Well, I'm equally honored and grateful for this opportunity to speak with someone who influenced history. James and Pamela, can you give us a quick bio on both of you, and then let's get into how you met and the divine connection there that happened. James, why don't we start with you?
Okay, I was born in 1942, January the 24th. I'm now 78 years old. I had special training as a child. I went to Camp Kuro at Long Island, New York, and at age 17, I went to the Army. I entered at Fort Linwood, Missouri for basic, took AIT at Fort Polk, Louisiana, signed up airborne, went to Fort Bragg, North Carolina, and July the 10th, we shipped out for Laos on Operation Mobile White Star. And from that to the Bay of Pigs, the Kennedy assassination, and many other operations along the way that I don't really want to get into. But basically speaking, it was a long life, a lot of history. And I was also involved with organized crime, not only with the CIA, but with organized crime. And I've got 28 years credited with the agency. And I did time in prison for shooting a police officer I didn't shoot. So I'm out now. I'm free. And Pamela and I are together at long last, and I'm thankful for that. I will let her explain the rest of it to you about how we come to be together.
Okay. Pamela, why don't you tell us a little bit about your faith background, and then tell us how you came to find out about James.
Okay. I was born in 1958 in Portland, Oregon, and I was raised in a non-Christian home. It was really a rough time in the 60s growing up. It was very confusing about what was really going on, and I graduated as a junior, same year my older brother graduated, and that was in 1975, and that's right when the Vietnam War ended, and I was really glad that he didn't have to go, because I thought he was going to go and probably die there,
mm-hmm.
And I was kind of anti-war, anti-gun, anti, you know, the way things were.
Sure.
Just kind of growing up crazy about all that was going on, and just kind of trying to make my way through it, but my mom wasn't really a real supportive mom, let's just say it that way.
Okay. And how did you come to faith in Christ from this agnostic atheist background?
I left Oregon in 1982. I had gone on a trip to Hawaii with a friend, and in 1982, I moved over to the Big Island, Kailua-Kona, and a friend of mine there was saying that he wanted a Christian wife, and I said, well, what is that? And he goes, what don't you understand? I go, well, what's a Christian? And he's like, you don't know? And I go, no, what's a Christian? And he's Catholic, and he didn't really know how to explain it to me very well, so he said, well, there's some people with the Youth with a Mission, YWAM, down in town, and they're having a coffee shop down there, and you can go down there and ask them questions. I went there and basically asked all the questions, and they answered them, and I said, well, if this is all true, and Jesus is alive, I'm out of the loop here. I want to get in the loop, and if it's real, I want to be part of it. And right. So I went and got a Bible, and the little old lady that prayed for me at the Christian bookstore there in Kailua-Kona, she prayed over it and prayed that God would really help me and guide me, and because I didn't even know what it was to be a Christian or what a Bible was or that there was an Old and New Testament, the word gospel. I'm raising my hand at the Bible study saying, what is that? You know,
wow.
And so they gave me the good news and I received it.
That's
and then
great.
The following week I said, well, I need to get baptized. So long story later, I got saved, baptized, and filled with the Holy Spirit over there in Kailua-Kona in 1982. And I was on a mission. I was going to let everybody know about Jesus. And so I sent my family Bibles. My sister got saved that Christmas. She had got the Bible and read it. And so I was just on a mission to save my family, all my friends. I was filled with God's joy. And I didn't understand the Bible. So I said, Lord, you're going to have to help me because I don't know what to say and when to say it and who to say it to. But he basically took me from that point on and used my life to help a lot of different people come to the Lord.
When I first talked to you on the phone, I could appreciate that spirit, and I really love that heart that you have to be an evangelist. That's amazing. So you've been a Christian and follower of Jesus since 1982. Now, how did you come to learn about James Files?
I was at the church library in 1997, and I had already, through the early 90s, late 80s, gone through this whole thing with Pat Robertson and the Christian Coalition. I volunteered all my time. Anyway, long story later, I felt very disassociated from the political process. I felt disenfranchised. I felt like Christians really didn't have a way to get out there and make a difference, and I felt pretty depressed about it. And I was like, Lord, you know, I'm just keeping my eyes focused on heaven because this earthly stuff is just driving me crazy. So
right.
I was in the library. Church library had a variety of things in it. It wasn't that big, but, you know, I was just in there. And I specifically went there because I had asked God to help me understand what was going on because nobody was able to tell me. And I wanted the Lord to lead me into understanding about end times, prophecy, just what's really happening. I had a hard time. Nobody was able to answer my questions, so I figured I'd go straight to the source. So I was in there wandering around looking for things. I saw tapes on Daniel. I saw expository books on the Bible. I was just wandering around, like, hey, Lord, anytime, speak up, and I'll grab something and let's learn. And so I was looking at the miscellaneous section he had, and down on the bottom shelf, right next to Rush Limbaugh's See, I Told You So, was this book called High Treason, The Assassination of John F. Kennedy, What Really Happened. I'm like, well,
intriguing title.
What's that? Because all my life I'd never thought about the JFK assassination. As a matter of fact, in the early 90s when Oliver Stone's movie came out and I was listening to Rush Limbaugh, like a good, faithful, right-wing Christian should, he said, don't go see the movie, it'll confuse you and it'll distort history and you don't want to go see it. So I never did. I didn't even think about JFK. So I saw that book in the church library and I was like, well, what the heck's that doing here? And what's it saying? High treason. So I took it home and I read it. And I was amazed that all this happened, and our country has been pretty much affected for the worst because of that assassination. And I took it back to the pastor, and I said, hey, I read this book, and we need to tell people at church about what's really happening and what happened back then. And he's like, no, we're not going to talk about this at church. And if you get into this conspiracy stuff, it's going to wreck your life. You can't do this. I'm like, well, now you tell me the book's in the library. I read it, and then now what?
A little late now.
Forget about it. And I said, no, I want to tell people. He goes, well, if you want to tell people, have a small group at your house and tell people about it there. And so I did. And so that lasted for a little while. And, you know, a few people came there. You know, I think I kind of was a little bit much for them. But anyway, that's in 1997. In 98, I found in a Blockbuster video store a movie the confession of assassin video. And I'm like, well, what's this? And then I was looking at it and reading the back, and I'm like, wow, this matches what that book said, and this guy says he was part of it, so I'm going to rent this and see what this guy's got to say. And then I watched it, and at the end, the interviewer was asking James Files if he believed in God after all these stories he's telling about the assassination, the FBI getting him, torturing him, almost died, you know, the cop trying to kill him, this, you know, all these things about where he should be dead, and he's asked if he believes in God, and he goes, I guess so. I find myself praying to him on several occasions.
Hmm.
And so I'm like, what? That guy isn't a Christian, and he survived all this? He needs to get saved, you know. My old evangelistic spirit kicking in. That guy needs to get saved. He needs to have somebody explain who Jesus is to him, because he's really close, but, I mean, he's not getting it yet. So I'm going to be his friend. I'm going to help him. Friendship evangelism. Here I come. I did not want a boyfriend in prison. I did not want, you know, our hearts to join the way God joined our hearts. I wasn't thinking about any of that stuff. It was just strictly, this guy needs to get saved. So I wrote him the first letter in February of 1999, told him I'd be his pen pal and encourage him, and, you know, I didn't even think he'd get the letter, and then he wrote me back.
That's amazing. Now, James, I want to ask you, from your perspective, what was your impression when you got this letter out of the blue from this woman who saw this video that you had done?
Well, when they gave me the letter at mail call, and I picked it up out of the bars. When I say bars, I'm talking my prison bars, not a bar you drink in. They come down the gallery and they put the mail in the bars. So when I picked it up in the bars there, and when I picked it up, it felt special. There's something about it. Something just struck me. I don't know what it was. I knew that letter was special. And I had received a lot of hate mail in prison, but I felt nothing like what I did with this letter. This was something altogether different. I got opened it, read it, and so I sat down and I wrote her back right away. So I wrote the letter back when we started corresponding. And then I think it was about July 1999. I woke up in my prison cell, probably 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning, and I found Jesus kneeling beside my bunk. Well, I stood up and I asked him, I said, Jesus, what are you doing here? And he said, the Father sent me. He told me to tell you that you're a non-believer, and that on the way to the Father is through me, Jesus Christ. You must become a believer. So we sit and we talked about a few different things, and I don't remember what it was all about, but then next thing I know, he was gone. Well, the next morning, I told a few of my friends about it. They said, oh, it's just a dream. Don't worry about it. I said, no, I said, this is real. Jesus was in my cell. He was right there in the cell with me. I stood up and talked to him. And it's just a dream. Forget about it. Anyway, but it really struck me, and so I decided I'm going to do right. So I stopped doing a lot of the crazy things I was doing. I tried not to fight with so many people. And I was continually having fights and going to seg, breaking people, busting heads, and hurting them real bad.
You were a very rough guy before this. Well, you still are in some senses. But how, you know, can you just give an idea to the audience of what you were like before Christ and then how it changed after this encounter with Jesus?
My life before Christ, I went to Camp Kuro as a child on a regular military base, and I took special training there. But it started at 8 years of age. At the time, I was age 10. I could throw a knife 30, 40 feet, hit the target, which is powerful enough to kill a man with it. I learned how to kill with a knife. I learned how to throw swift weapons, do everything I had to do. I was an excellent shot. I made my mark in Laos in Operation Mobile White Star. I entered the Army at age 17 on my 17th birthday, January the 24th, 1959. We shipped out July 10th. And with the previous training that I had, I was way ahead of any of the other recruits at Fort Linwood, Missouri, also at Fort Brooke, Louisiana for the AIP, and also at Airborne. And I couldn't wait to jump out of my first airplane.
Wow.
And so we went to Laos. I made my mark there. And before my 18th birthday that January, I had 17 confirmed kills. When I say confirmed kills, I'm not talking about people in firefights. I'm talking about a primary target. And I was really rated for my rank because of the expert marksman that I was.
Hmm.
But I started hunting rabbits like at age 5 or 6 years of age, squirrel, and we hunted those, killed them, we ate them for breakfast. One shot, one kill with it back then.
Right.
Anyway, but after Operation Mobile White Star, I came back. I went to work training for the Bay of Pigs, but I had 17 primary kills that were primary targets. That's why this last book is called Primary Target.
Right.
I went through the Bay of Pigs, then Luis Posada Guerrillas. Him and I became very close. We were the first two people recruited for Operation Group 40 by George Bush Sr.
My goodness.
At that time, in 1961 and 62, when he was hanging out with us during the Bay of Pigs operations and everything, he was a recruiter for the CIA.
You were an assassin. You were a stone-cold killer, basically.
I was. That's what it was.
Okay.
I dropped the hammer on a primary target, but I put him in the crosshairs. They were gone, and I felt no remorse whatsoever.
My goodness.
And in time, I come to lead one of the largest. I led a company of mercenaries for quite a while. We worked in Africa. We were just about everywhere. And I led a company of mercs, and I told everybody, like I told Pamela, I led the biggest batch of scumbags to ever walk the face of this earth.
Hmm.
And I was probably the biggest of all of them. I'm not proud of it.
Okay.
But that's we did the job nobody else could do. A very good friend of ours, Lieutenant Colonel Dan Marvin, called Dangerous Dan, Green Beret. He was captain of Green Beret, finally made colonel, lieutenant colonel. He passed away. He was trying to get us to testify before Congress, him, two other men, and myself. They approved the three, but they refused to let me testify before Congress because of national security. So they didn't know what I would say.
Yeah.
But Dan was asked the questions, him and the Green Beret, and they refused a lot of operations because they were immoral.
Hmm.
But when something came up that was immoral, then they used mercenaries. That was us.
Okay.
We're all contract agents for the CIA.
My gosh.
And anyway, I never looked back, and that's how it was. And I studied in martial arts. I studied in Demhesh. In the East, they call it Demhesh. In the West, they call it Denmak. And that is where you kill people without using a weapon. You kill them with your bare hands.
My gosh. Now, James, I remember in your video, your 2003 interview, you talk about your encounter with Jesus, and then the next day you felt very light. You were even friendly towards the guards. Hey, how you doing? Didn't want to stab anybody. But can you describe what Stateville was like and then the change in you that happened?
Well, after all this went down and I finally got caught up and I went to prison for shooting a police officer. I did not shoot. Long story there. But anyway, when I got there, I went in fighting with everybody. I didn't care. I didn't want no friends. I didn't want to know nobody. And Stateville Prison is one of the toughest prisons in the country, maximum security, and the wall is like 32 to 33 feet high. You don't see nothing beyond that wall. The only thing you see flying over is birds, planes, and clouds.
Hmm.
And it's a very rough prison to be in, and I fought very hard there. But after my first encounter with Jesus, I started feeling a different feeling. I didn't hate nobody. And I even went to the child I saw, a good friend of mine, Barry. He was doing four natural life sentences. And he says, I'm going to tell him, he says, I said, you're crazy. I said, no, I said, come on. I said, slap me. I'll turn the other cheek. He said, you're crazy. I slapped. He says, you'll kill me. I said, no, I won't. I said, slap me. He wouldn't do it. So we butted head, everything. But the people seen I was really serious. But after a couple of months, I started slipping back. And as I slipped back, I was getting way off track again and forgetting about Jesus, God, and everything. So I got a second visit from Jesus.
Hmm.
And when he come there and I woke up, sit up in my bunk, I asked him, I says, how come you're here? What's going on? He said, the Father sent me to tell you to get your life in order that he will soon call you home.
Oh, boy.
So I said, okay, you know, I figure I'm going to die pretty soon now. Something's going to happen. So anyway, so we talked a little bit and he left. And I called Pamela and told her about it. So we sit and we talk, we prayed on the phone and everything. And then I'm reading the Bible and I'm reading about the earth giving pains, earth pains and everything. Then I knew, I'm not dying now. God is talking about the end of times is coming.
You're reading Matthew 24?
Yeah, Matthew 24, yes.
Okay.
And so I read all that and just now I'm really, well, I ain't dying right away. So, you know, that's good news. But anyway, so the family and I tried to lead a better life. I stopped doing a lot of the crazy things I was doing. I stopped fighting with everybody. I started trying to give respect to people. I started trying to show more kindness, in other words, okay?
Mm. Yeah.
Because if somebody looked the wrong way, I was used to, you know, busting heads.
Wow.
And so I got over all that, so I started living a good life. And I gave my life to Jesus at that time, but I really wasn't safe at that point because, like I told God when I prayed, I says, I'm in a rough place. I said, I don't want to tell you that I'm going to be good at everything. I says, I'm going to work hard and try to follow Jesus, and I want to follow in the right footsteps, but I don't want to promise you something when I know I'm going to have to kill somebody the next day.
Hmm.
It was like in one of my interviews, they said, when you leave your cell of a day, what do you think you're going to do that day? I said, I don't think about what I'm going to do that day. I wonder who I'm going to have to kill that day.
Wow.
This is how violent Stateville was. And so finally when I got out, then I got baptized, and now I don't hurt nobody. I try to have understanding.
Good.
I got a Trump hat. I wear some guy flipped me off, and when he did, I looked at him, and I said, thank you, sir. I didn't argue with him. When I met with Jesse, we spent 7 hours with Jesse Ventura here a couple months back. Jesse walked into the room, and he looks around. There's about 25, 30 of us there. He goes, who's James Files? Where's he at? Who's James Files? I want to see him. I said, that would be me. He said, I, Lincoln, despise you. I said, that's okay, Jesse. You're still my hero. And he just looked at me and said, well, I don't despise you. I despise what you did to our president in 1963.
Oh, so he knew.
Well, it was a job.
Okay.
But we spent 7 hours together. He talked to us. And he invited Pamela and me to be on his TV show. I didn't even think about it. I just said no.
Wow. Well, Jimmy, I'm honored that you're doing this interview for me. And we got to take a quick break here. But when we come back, I want to hear all about what led up to and the day of November 22nd, 1963, when American history and the world history was changed in an instant. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with more of James and Pamela Files on Divine Intervention Radio.
You're listening to Divine Intervention with Daniel Pazina, and we'll return in just a moment. I believe in miracles.
Divine Intervention is supported by FarewellMortgage.com. With FarewellMortgage.com, you can learn how to eliminate your home mortgage and replace it with a home equity line of credit. This can help you pay off your home years faster and save you thousands in mortgage interest. My wife and I said farewell to our mortgage and replaced it with a first lien HELOC, and now we're set to save 25 years and over $100,000 in mortgage interest. More information about this better way to finance real estate can be found at FarewellMortgage.com.
Hi, this is Cha-Cha from The Sopranos and the unofficial mayor of Little Italy, and you're listening to Divine Intervention with Daniel Fazina.
Because we all make mistakes sometimes, and we all step across that line, but nothing sweeter than the day we find, we find.
It's hanging over him like the clouds of Seattle. It raining on his swag, falling deeper in the saddle. It's written on his face, he don't have to speak a sound. Somebody call the 5-0, we got a man down. Now you can go and play it like you're all rock and roll, but guilt does a job on each and every man's soul. And when your head hits the pillow at the nightfall, you can bet your life that it's gonna be a fight, y'all. Cause we all make mistakes sometimes, and we've all stepped across that line, but nothing sweeter than the day we find. Forgiveness.
Welcome back to Divine Intervention Radio. I'm your host, Daniel Fazina. And if you're just tuning in, we have been speaking with James Files and his wife, Pamela Ray Files. They are the authors of several books, including Interview with History, The JFK Assassination, and Primary Target, JFK, How the CIA Used the Chicago Mob to Kill the President. James Files is the admitted Grassy Knoll shooter, the assassin who shot John F. Kennedy from the Grassy Knoll in 1963, that fateful day, November 22nd. James and Pamela, welcome back.
Oh, thank you, Daniel. Thank you.
Sure. Now, before the break, James, we talked about your conversion experience and how you're now following the Lord, and you gave us a little bit of a background about how you were a mercenary, you worked for the CIA, you worked for organized crime, you've done many years in prison. All told, how much time have you spent behind bars, if you don't mind me asking?
32 years.
32 years, amazing. Now, you and I were pen pals since about 2009. Developed a relationship, and I had seen the 2003 interview you did from Stateville, Illinois, and I was intrigued, to say the least. And then when you talked about your conversion experience and your visit from Jesus, almost like the Apostle Paul when he was Saul on the road to Damascus, I mean, you actually got to see Jesus. He appeared to you just like he did with Saul. I remember when Pamela and I talked, Pamela, you had an interesting reaction to that. What was it? You know, you'd been praying for Jimmy and witnessing to him, but what did you think when he told you that he actually got a visit or two from Jesus?
Well, I was very thankful to the Lord that he would do that. And I was like, well, is he a Christian now? And that was just something I was wondering, is if that was something that really happened. And I was trying to talk to Jimmy about it. And so when we decided that I was going to come and visit him in 2000, that's when I came into the visiting room. That's the first time I saw him, in September of 2000. And in the visiting room, he got on the floor on his knees, and I'm like, did you drop something? What are you doing down there? And he looked into my eyes, and he was holding my hand, and he asked me if I would marry him if he ever got his freedom. He wanted me to be his wife and partner in life, and I was really shocked because I knew he cared about me, but I didn't know he felt that way about me. So, yeah, I said, well, as the Lord leads and guides me, yes. I mean, I just didn't think he was going to ever get out of prison, so I didn't know what was really going to happen next.
That's amazing.
Got in his chair, and then he asked me if I would write books with him, a book, the To Kill a Country book, and I still wasn't sure if he was really serious. And I'm like, why would you want me to do that? And he said, because you have a way with words and you're really smart and I want you to do it. And I don't trust anybody else to get the truth out there. So
wow.
That's what started all that.
That's amazing. And so your engagement lasted over 15 years then, right?
Well, it started
years.
In 1999. February is when I first wrote him.
18 years. Wow, that's incredible. Jimmy, I want you to take us to 1963, the events that led up to the Kennedy assassination, and tell us, you know, what your involvement was and walk us through the whole thing in as much detail as you can.
I want to say one thing about it.
Sure.
I want to say one thing prior to that.
Sure.
I did not come forward of my own free will on the Kennedy assassination.
Okay.
The FBI knew about my involvement as early as 1964.
Right.
They had a federal informant, what we call a 5-0 federal informant. He had informed the FBI that I participated in the Kennedy assassination and I was the guy on the grassy knoll.
Okay.
The FBI is the one that gave me up to the investigator, Joe West, in 91 or 92, whatever it was. And Joe West made contact with me. And then that, the rest is history. I'll go back to the beginning.
Okay.
When I come back from Operation Mobile White Star, went to work on the Bay of Pigs. Went through that session, came home. I started racing stock cars out of the Harris Stadium, and I was pretty good at it. Been my lifelong dream to race, and I loved racing all my life. And one of the gentlemen from town was involved in organized crime, who used to work with Milwaukee Phil, who was a notorious hitman, and Charles Nicoletti was the guy that come in hard to be his driver. And Charles Nicoletti was a notorious hitman, and I would be driving for him when I'm home on different assignments and things, and later I became his bodyguard. But also, we went through that and we developed a close relationship, and I was sitting at the Harlow Grill, and this is like 6 months prior to the assassination of JFK, when Charles Nicoletti walked in, and I was playing the pinball machine in the back room. He said, Jimmy, let's go, I gotta talk to you. Be with you in a minute, boss. He reached over, told the machine, it says, now. I said, yes, sir, Mr. Nicoletti. So we got up, we left, and he says, we're going to do your friend. And I said, what the blank did he do now? He said, no, not him. He said, I'm talking about the president, John F. Kennedy. I said, okay, may help, anything's fine. So he told me, he said, I'm bringing in Johnny Roselli. He's going to be working with us. I said, fine, I like Johnny, because I knew Johnny from hearing the Bay of Pigs action with the SAO, which is run by Frank Sturgis, and the SAO was a secret army organization when we were planning the invasion of Cuba, the Bay of Pigs, which is better known as Chianos Bay. And I started driving to Chuck's. He told me I'd be going to Dallas a week in advance. I would go down there, study, learn the area. I'm going to be the driver and the weapons bearer. I was not to be a shooter. My job was to transfer weapons down there, transport them, and know the area. So if anything goes wrong, we're in a high-speed chase, I'm going to go down a dead-end street or go where the railroad crossing is with the train crossing and wreck the whole day. I think it really spoil your day. So anyway, I went down there, spent a week. I spent 5 days prior to the assassination with Lee Harvey Oswald.
Okay.
People in the world knew where I was at. One was Charles Nicoletti, and the other was my controller, who was David Atlee Phillips. And I called David Atlee Phillips every day when not on assignment, but I would call him to check to see if he had things for me to do, wanted me available or whatever. And he was always free to go at a moment's notice. When he called, you dropped whatever you're doing, you grabbed your go bag and jumped on the plane and went wherever you had to go for your assignment. You would meet up at one of the military bases and then be transported on a match flight out of this country. And they use match flights because they're known as a black flight, because there'd be no flight plan file and nobody knew who was on that plane.
So David Atlee anyway, Phillips was your CIA controller, your handler.
Yes, he was my CIA controller.
Okay.
Well, today they call them handlers. Back then they call them controllers.
Okay.
Okay. I spent 5 days prior to the assassination in Dallas with Lee Harvey Oswald. He showed me around Dallas. The reason he knew I was there was I contacted, I made two phone calls. I called Charles Nicoletti, told him I was in Dallas. I called David Atlee Phillips and told David Atlee Phillips where I was at, and that I was on stage in the area, ready to go. And he sent Lee Harvey Oswald to show me around Dallas, because Charles Nicoletti did not know Lee Harvey Oswald.
Okay.
So Lee knocked on my door and went open the door. I'd known him from before because we were running guns together down to Clinton, Louisiana. We were shipping at that time over to Haiti to Papa Doc. And I asked him, I said, what the blank are you doing here? He said, the boss sent me here to show you around Dallas. I said, okay. So he showed me the area of Dallas pretty well, and I learned the streets and crossings and everything since I was being the driver. And I calibrated the scopes out at Mesquite and salvage yard. And then the one report committee, whatever you want to call it, the one where the Congress had it on the assassination committee.
Yes.
Some woman testified.
Warren Commission.
Yeah, Warren Commission. Some lady that testified that she witnessed two teenagers out in the field shooting rifles just a few days prior to the assassination.
That would have been so you and...
Harvey Oswald and me. And
okay.
Calibrating the scope. Lee Harvey Oswald never fired the weapon. He picked up the brass. That is why when the paraffin test revealed residue in the palm of his hand, that was him holding the brass that ejected from the weapon that was calibrating the scopes on.
All right.
Anyway... Chuck asked me to be his backup. Gunnar Roselli decided not to be backup. And Chuck told me that Johnny had second thoughts about it because Johnny was licensed between the CIA and the Chicago mob.
Oh, boy.
And the CIA said they wanted to call the hit off. Well, they didn't want to stop the hit. But Johnny decided not to shoot because they were sending in an abort team that day to stop it, you know, to stop the assassination. Well, they didn't send them to stop, but what they did, they sent it in to cover themselves in case something went wrong. They could say they sent the abort team in, and they could take credit for saving Kennedy's life. Since everything went right, everybody got out of Dodge and left, except for Lee, and he ran into problems. That story's in the book also.
Right.
But other than that, everything went the way it was supposed to.
So what was your...
went back to Chicago and never looked back.
What was your role, though? I mean, you were a backup shooter?
I went down as a weapons bearer and driver.
Okay.
And I wound up being the secondary shooter to Charles Nicoletti.
Okay, so he and, from my understanding, he and Johnny Roselli were on the roof of the Dal-Tex building?
No.
No.
Charles Nicoletti fired from an office on the second floor.
Okay, not the roof. Okay. But it was the Dal-Tex building.
And Johnny Roselli was with him. Johnny Roselli picked up the brass that he ejected from his weapon. And me, when I ejected the one shot that I took, I bit the shell casing and I left it sitting on the fence.
Now, where were you?
I was on the grassy knoll behind the stockade fence.
Okay.
Overlooking the plaza.
And you were supposed to be a backup shooter. How would you know to be a backup? I mean, how would you know to take the shot or
when
not?
When they didn't have the headshot, and we're going for a headshot, I'm in position, and I'm fixing to lose my field of fire. Either I take the shot, or I put it in the briefcase, my gun case, and walk away, and then I have to explain why I failed to take the shot. And you don't really want to explain to the outfit why you didn't take the shot when he was there.
Hmm.
So I took the shot.
And what?
And I hit the target, and I hit him in the right temple, and it removed the back portion of his head.
And you're actually from the right front of the motorcade, correct?
Right. The right front of the motorcade.
Now, I've been to Dealy Plaza. I've stood behind the stockade fence. And from the fence to the road, I was surprised at how short of a distance it was. It was very close.
It is.
It looks a lot bigger in the pictures, I think.
It is. A lot of people are amazed when they see how small that plaza is and how congested it is.
And how far would you say it was from you to the president?
The shot that I took was 88 feet.
88 feet. That's very close.
Mm-hmm. Very close.
And
I could say I used the Remington Fireball 221.
Okay. And that's a single-shot pistol?
Single-shot bolt-action pistol, yes.
Okay. Wow. And so, now who, do you know who ordered this hit?
I have no idea who ordered it. All I know is the outfit wanted him dead, and orders came down from somewhere on high, and the CA wanted to get rid of Kennedy. So I give the CA the credit for wanting him gone, because we had previously asked Kennedy for permission to work with the Brits on assassinating a general in Europe. And Kennedy said, no, we're going to supply the weaponry, the technology, nor the personnel. So we went around Kennedy, did the assassination anyway, and that is when he gave his famous speech, and he beat the podium with his fist, was yelling that he's going to smash the CIA into 1,000 pieces, scattered to the wind, and what is left he was going to give to the JCS. For those who don't know what the JC is, that's your Joint Chiefs of Staff, and let them run it. Well, the people at the CIA at that point said, no, this ain't happening. Kennedy's got to go.
So that you think the CIA ordered it, and then they used the Chicago mob, which you were a part of,
right,
to carry it out.
Yes.
That's...
Now, the reason with the Chicago mob was this. They wanted to get rid of Castro, and Johnny Roselli at the time was a well-known hitman himself. Before he came up the ranks, he started out as a hitman. And he also used the aliases Colonel Ralston. But when they asked Johnny Roselli to assassinate Castro, to kill Castro, and they told him, we will pay you $100,000 to do it, he told him, he says, no, I don't want your money. I'll do it for free because I'm a patriot.
Wow.
And so they never got rid of Castro, because I learned many years later that the CIA never wanted to get rid of Castro because they put him into power. And we took Batista out and put Castro into power.
Hmm.
And we used him basically for the heroin trade coming out of Southeast Asia at the time, after World War II.
Unbelievable. So you took the shot.
And so then they wanted to get rid of Kennedy. They called in Johnny Roselli, and they sent him. So Johnny Roselli went and told Sam Giancana, who was the number two man, because Johnny Roselli couldn't act without permission from Sam. So he told Sam that the CIA wanted to get rid of Castro. Sam was gleeful about it because Castro kicked the outfit out of Cuba and everybody lost their casinos and their money and the hotels and everything.
My goodness.
Before Sam Giancana could okay that, he had to go get it approved by Tony Accardo, who was number one. And Tony Accardo was the number one man until the day he died.
You're talking about the Chicago organized crime outfit.
Chicago organized crime, yes.
My goodness. So Tony Accardo gave the approval to Sam. Sam handed it out to Chuck. Chuck brought in Johnny and you?
To Johnny. He gave it to Johnny Roselli.
Okay.
And then they called. Then Sam called Chuck in. And, Chuck had no part of the first one because the first one was to get rid of Castro.
Okay.
They didn't get rid of Castro. So then the CIA decided to use Johnny Roselli to go to the mob to have them do John F. Kennedy.
Okay.
So then Sam calls Chuck in. And then Chuck come and got me at the Harlow Grill, and then he's telling me that, you know, he's called Johnny Roselli, and I said, I got no problem, I like Johnny, because we worked together in the Church of Bay of Pigs and things. And
so you were the infamous Grassy Knoll Shooter. Now, the Zapruder film captured this event on film, and it spawned multiple books and movies and this conspiracy theory, but yet the Warren Commission said that Lee Harvey Oswald killed John F. Kennedy acting alone, shooting from behind, but there is this theory of the Grassy Knoll Shooter. What do you have to say about that?
Once the government tells a lie, they have to live the lie.
Wow.
On the back of our book, Daniel, it says 100 years from now, most history books will say Lee Harvey Oswald was the lone assassin and there is no conspiracy to kill President John F. Kennedy. Truth is, CIA wanted JFK dead and they used the Chicago mob. Like I say, once the government tells a lie, they have to live the lie. James Files, the Grassy Knoll Shooter.
Now, James, I have to ask you, why have you decided to give me this interview? And are you concerned that you're going to bring more heat on yourself than you already had? Because, I mean, how many attempts have you had on your life up to this point?
I've had several. That's what put me in prison for 25 years. The two cops that come after me were off duty. They made the attempt on me 30 miles from where they were cops. They ambushed me out of their own town, 30 miles away. And like I say, I won the shootout, but lost the war. But before that, I had been run over. People had tried to kill me. And I thought I had done something with the outfit that they were disturbed. And I went and I saw the old man, had a talk with him. And he told me, he said, no. He said, look at your previous employers. He says, Jimmy, he said, you did your federal time. He says, when you got out, you got all the respect. You went and had a cup of coffee, and everybody stopped by to see you to say hello, and they dropped an envelope in the bag. They said, you had all your startup money. Your family was taken care of while you was gone. He said, you had no problems. He said, your problems were your previous employers. So then...
Meaning the government.
I found out later that the cops had a contract on me for $50,000, and I blamed the CIA for the ones wanting to kill me, and I even wrote them a letter and told them I'm very disappointed. I thought I was worth a lot more than $50,000. I figured the contract should have been at least $500,000. It wasn't about the JFK assassination. This was about Mena, Arkansas, and it wasn't the CIA that wanted me dead. It was Hillary Clinton and her group that wanted me dead, because at that time, Bill was getting ready to run for the president. I was the only one. I was one of the guys. I flew in over 100 trips in and out of Mena, Arkansas with drugs.
Oh, my gosh.
And Barry Seals and I was very good friends. I don't know if you know who Barry Seals was or not.
I do not.
Well, he was the one that was flying the plane, the fat lady. And he barred the plane. The DA barred it from the CIA. And it was shot down over Honduras with Barry Seals, or not Barry, but with Cook and Sawyer on it, and Eugene Havenpuss. Eugene Havenpuss was the kicker. He was out of Marriott, Wisconsin. He had a parachute on the board, which he shouldn't have had, because we flew without parachutes for one reason. That the plane goes down, we all die. This way, dead men tell no secrets.
My goodness.
But he had a parachute he bailed out. He was captured in Central America and gave up everybody on it. But Barry Seals had used the fat lady prior to that, before it was shot down, to film all the drug bases for the cocaine and the heroin that was coming in out of Southeast Asia and from South America up to Mexico and through there.
My goodness.
America, so.
I've heard
of the Iran-Contra scandal.
Yeah, this conspiracy goes deep, and I wish we could talk for more about it. Unfortunately, we're running up against time, but for anyone listening, Jimmy, I mean, you've told me in your letters that you've had several occasions where you should have been dead, and you feel like God had warned you, even when you were in a firefight, you had a premonition that saved you, and there's so many attempts on your life. Why do you think
God gave me visions. God gave me visions to see things that I saw would actually happen to save my life several occasions.
Well, I think it's obvious that he had a plan for your life, but what is your purpose now giving this interview? What do you want the American people to know?
Well, I just want the American people to know the truth, and Lee Harvey Oswald never fired a shot. Lee Harvey Oswald did not kill John F. Kennedy. And I'd like for people to understand his family is not to blame. And I'd like for his kids to know that their father is a decent human being and that their father worked for the CIA, but he did not kill John F. Kennedy.
Okay.
So they're blaming the family for something that never happened. So became the path of the government.
Now, I understand there's no statute of limitations on murder. Are you concerned about this confession at all?
No, not at all, because they will never put me on trial. I'm one of the last people ever be put on trial to try for that, because I know too many government secrets.
Wow.
I spent all the years working in some of the darkest covert operations ever ran by men. And the CIA, I mean, we violated rules and everything. We did domestic operations, which was illegal. And I have worked in Eastern Europe, Africa, Central America, South America, Southeast Asia. I mean, they have sent me all over. And... like I say, we're not writing my life story about what happened. We're only writing one chapter about Kennedy.
Hmm.
I don't really want my life story ever told, because I don't want my kids to know really how bad I was.
Wow. Well, now that you've had your visits from Jesus and you're growing as a Christian, and you've been released from prison after serving a total of 32 years, how is your life different now, and what do you want to do going forward?
I want to live my life in peace, and I want to spend my life with Pamela. and I want us to be happy, and I just want to enjoy life. I'm not like I used to be. I've turned around. I try to understand people better, and I'm still trying to learn it, and I'm still trying to get some of my emotionals back. And our life is pretty hard for Pamela because sometimes I don't show enough tenderness or kindness. I've asked God to help me get my emotions back so we can have a closer relationship and I have more compassion for my fellow man.
Hmm. And finally, James, one last question. You've had people like Oliver Stone try to get your help and Jesse Ventura tried to interview you. You told him no. Why me? Why are you doing this interview for me?
We were pen pals. We got to talk. I got to support. I like you and I respect you. And above all, I trust you. And I know that your heart is in the right place. These other people, I know that all they're after is the money and a story that's going to be here today and gone tomorrow. They want to get their dollars out of it, and that's it. Mm. They have no interest in the truth whatsoever.
Wow. And Pamela, what do you want to say to the American people? I mean, you've co-wrote these books, Interview with History, the JFK Assassination, and your latest book is called Primary Target, JFK, How the CIA Used the Chicago Mob to Kill the President. What do you want the people to take away from this, these books and this interview?
Okay, well, it's really important that the information about the JFK assassination is out there once and for all. That's important. But the biggest story here is that James Files is now a Christian, and that God got a hold of him and changed his heart. Some people, I guess, Jesus has to physically show up to get that much attention into you, because James Files was very lost and very far from God, even though he found himself praying to God on several occasions. God kept him alive for his own purposes. And at the end of our book, James Files says if he can get saved and washed by the blood of Jesus, anybody can. Hmm. And I think that's a very true statement. I mean, we're all sinners. We're all at the foot of the cross. And I just hope people can, you know, in their heart, forgive James Files for his past, like Jesus did, and help him be a Christian, encourage him to be a Christian. He used to go out and just take a gun and go get money his way. Now he's having to believe God to provide for him, to provide for us. Walking by faith is something he's never done before in his life, and we've been doing it together, and I just hope people can be encouraged in the Lord to believe for anybody to get saved, because I believed for James Files to get saved, and look what the Lord did.
Mm.
Look how much truth's coming out, because he's willing to open up and let the truth be known, and that's what we put in our book, Primary Target.
That's amazing. Well,
I want to say one thing, Daniel.
Sure, go ahead.
I give God credit walking me through all the things that I've been involved in and keeping me alive. I give God credit for that, because without God, I couldn't have done it. And I had no idea that he was touching over me that close.
Hmm.
And now I realize it.
It's amazing. It's amazing that you're still here, James, and I applaud you and I thank you for coming forward with the truth. And Pamela, I applaud you and thank you for reaching out to James and witnessing to him and praying for him. This has been an amazing interview, and I thank you both for sharing your testimony here on Divine Intervention Radio. God bless you both.
Thank you, Daniel. God bless you and your family.
Thank you. Well, friend, that about does it for another exciting episode of Divine Intervention Radio. I hope it has encouraged you to know that nobody is beyond God's grace, and he is still changing the world one heart at a time. Take care, and God bless.
You've been listening to Divine Intervention with your host, Daniel Fazina. You can email Daniel at divineintervention@mail.com. That's divineintervention@mail.com. All programs of Divine Intervention are available online at divineinterventionradio.com. That's divineinterventionradio.com. Join us next time here on Divine Intervention.